Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to another video. As you can see by the title of this video, you know, Survivor 44 just came out, and I'd like to give you my thoughts and opinions on it. And real quick, let me just say the gameplay you're about to see in the background is blessed. I had myself a day in this game, so just letting you know. Yeah, am I flexing my Call of Duty gameplay? Yes, I am. Alright, anyway, let's get straight into the video about my opinions on Survivor 44 Episode 1. So coming into the season, honestly, I wasn't too high on the cast. There's only a couple people that I thought stand out. A lot of these people felt like people that were casted to be like early boots. Like, almost when I looked at the cast, I was like, a lot of these people just seem like early boots, and I was right about that. I think a lot of this cast just, you know, there's not a lot of standout guys. Like, there's no like Cody or something like that, you know, it's gonna stand out on the cast. However, the one person that I thought was cool in the cast was Brandon Cottam, and we'll get to him in a second. He's my boy, though. So, you know, you get to the episode, everything starts, you know, Jeff gives his whole spiel about how this is the new era of Survivor, it's dangerous, blah, 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 blah. And they start the first challenge, and Bruce, like, I think he kind of cracks his head on one of the challenge sets. They stop the challenge for a sec, but then the doctors say he's actually okay, and they resume the challenge. And I think that the Purple Tribe actually sells because of Carolyn. The Purple Tribe sells. The Purple Tribe has a lead in the challenge, but they end up losing because Carolyn, because she sucks. And I think that the Green Tribe wins. So then they go back to the islands, and let me get into a mini rant real quick. 4 seasons in a row, we got Savvy and Sweat. Do we really need the Savvy and Sweat challenges? Like, let's be honest with ourselves. Do we need the Savvy and Sweat challenges? The answer is no, we don't. I don't get why we keep having these, okay? Like, if this was a thing since the very beginning, and it's like, okay, that's how it's always been, cool, but like, we really don't need these Savvies and Sweat challenges. And no one has actually failed a Savvy and Sweat challenge. Both the tribes from this season also did not fail the Savvy and Sweat challenges. So is it really that much of a challenge if no one has ever failed it? I don't think so. Both the tribes completed the challenge, so both of them got their materials, their rice, what have you. Then let's get into something interesting about the season. So the players walk into the new you know, beaches, and basically the first thing you see when you get on this beach is this cage that has a key on it, and there's assumedly there's a key hidden somewhere in the island that you can open this cage. And this brings up a lot of, you know, someone could find it, you know, open the cage, and we wouldn't know because they could just close the cage again and hide the key. But most of the tribe seemed to just not really put too much thought into it at first, and just really focused on building the shelter. And this idle cage twist thing, well, we don't know it's an idle yet, but this cage twist aid doesn't really get too much momentum until near the halfway part of the episode. So, you know, we get a couple more camp life scenes, what have you. And then, like about halfway through the episode, the only person to find the key in the first episode for the cage is Brandon, and he finds it with Maddie. Maddie originally is like, maybe we should just not tell everyone and keep this between you and me. But Brandon doesn't really want to work with Maddie. You know, he thinks she's a snake, stuff like that. So he actually ends up telling everyone that he found the key. Now, mind you, no one knows what it is. So he's thinking probably maybe this is a thing to, you know, build team chemistry. They go, they open the cage, and it's an idol. And that instantly puts a target on Brandon's back. Which sucks because Brandon's my boy. But yeah, it is an idol. So now that we all know that, I thought it'd be something else, honestly. But yep, it's an idol, which raises the question, are there idols? Is there actually a hidden immunity idol in any of the camps? Because the hidden immunity idol is in the cage. So we actually don't know that yet. I assume no. I guess this is the only idol. I don't think there'd be another idol hidden in the beaches, because that just wouldn't make sense. And then right before the next immunity challenge, actually, Bruce gets medevaced. Yeah, Bruce gets medevaced. His head apparently wasn't actually all good, and he just starts fainting, and medical has to get him out of the game. And something interesting is, if you don't know, Jeff made a Survivor podcast, and he straight up just said they're inviting Bruce to come back on the show. So at some point, because I guess maybe Bruce is the person that had the least amount of time on Survivor. I think he was only on for like 12 hours. So I get it. But Bruce is confirmed to be coming back in another season. So the first person in the new era to be confirmed to come back 100% is Mr. Bruce from this season, which I think is interesting. And then a little bit later, we actually See, another person tries to get medevaced. Matthew tries to climb up this giant slippery rock. I don't know why. He slips and cuts himself. He doesn't get medevaced. He's fine. But his arm is going to be in a sling. And he better be thanking Bruce right now that he got medevaced. Because if he had to play in the challenge, that would have sucked. But since Bruce actually, you know, died. No, he didn't die. But since Bruce got medevaced, Matthew gets sit on the next challenge. And then right before the challenge, we also get the island twist. Every single time this season, every single one of these new seasons, there's always an island. And this time, I really don't like this one. So, three people go to the island. It's Matthew, Sarah, and Lauren. And they go to the island, and they don't really talk. They don't actually talk, and they just get to this path, and there's three different, you know, paths on the mountain, and each of them got to go down it. They don't really talk to each other, and they just go. Here's what I don't like about it. So, this little twist in the game is when they get there, they have a decision to make. There is a bag with a no vote and an advantage. And but it was actually in the bag, there's two no votes and one advantage. And they can't even decide if they want to risk it and risk their vote and try to get the advantage. No, they have to risk their vote. They have to put their hand in the bag and grab something out. And basically the way it works is if you put your hand in the bag, you grab and you actually get the paper that says you have advantage, then you just get the advantage and you leave. But if you grab a paper that says no vote, you can actually grab another paper and risk losing your votes for two tribals. Or if you get the advantage, you don't lose your vote at all. So Matthew, you know, picks up the paper, it's no vote, and he actually goes again, and it's no vote again. So Matthew, and this one's Blankenship, not the other Matthew. Matthew Blankenship cannot vote for the first two tribal councils, so he's kind of screwed. Sarah gets the advantage on the first try. And Sarah's, she's an OP advantage. So I'm still not sure quite how it works. I've talked to a couple people about this. But I think the way it works is she gets any advantages that are used at a tribal council. So, you know, I don't know if she plays in secret or plays it publicly. But, yeah, she gets to basically get every single advantage that is used in a tribal council. After they use, she actually gets them after the tribal council, which is, like, really weird. It's OP. And then Lauren actually gets a no vote in her first one, and then she gets the advantage. She goes again, she gets the advantage. And actually, I don't know if it was Sarah or Laura that originally got a no vote, and then did it again and got, I think Sarah risked her vote again, actually, and then Lauren got on the first try. Lauren gets a banked vote advantage, which means if she doesn't vote for one tribal, she gets to keep the paper that she didn't vote with and get an extra vote. Personally, I think that this island thing is BS. There is no way that all three people got different results. Matthew got, you know, lose your vote twice. Sarah, I think, was the one that lost the vote initially, but then got the advantage on the second try. And then Lauren got her advantage on the first try. There is no way that all three of them got all three exact options. You know, I think this challenge is BS. I think production rigged it. So yeah, this is fake. So we get to the challenge. The tribes learned that Bruce was medevaced, and Matthew, the ones in the cast, and another girl named Claire, they're the ones that sit out. The challenge is boring, whatever, but something interesting actually happens is Claire talks to Matthew while they're sitting out, and they kind of talk about the stories that each person told them when they got back to camp, and they realize the stories don't match up. So Matthew realizes that Lauren was actually lying to him because the other Matthew who came back from the island actually showed them his no vote paper. Lauren did not show a no vote paper, so Matthew realizes that Lauren is lying about not having an advantage because Lauren just simply said that she lost her vote, but now we know that isn't true. Anyway, the orange tribe loses the challenge. I gotta remember these tribe names, guys. Honestly, I gotta remember these tribe names because I'm not doing that good of due diligence right now. I need to remember these tribe names, but orange tribe loses, and you know, all the crazy stuff going on. Lauren actually wants to get rid. She's the one that spearheads. Maddie wants to get rid of Brandon. Lauren originally, I don't think, really has anything going on. But then Maddie tells her, hey, we need to get rid of Brandon because power or whatever. And they try to get Jamie in. And she's freaking out. Jamie's freaking out day three about a simple vote. Kane originally with Matthew, and Brandon said they're going to vote for Lauren, but then Maddie brings them in on this plan, brings Kanan on this plan about voting off Brandon, and he seems like he kind of agrees. And then Jamie says she's actually going to use her shot in the dark, and everyone says don't use it, so she said, okay, I won't. But we get the tribal council, and before, you know, they vote, Jamie straight up says, hey, I'm using my shot in the dark, which to me is like, I don't like this move because she's just too scared. It wasn't like a strategic move. She was just too scared to actually vote or something like that. Crazy, I know, right? And then Lauren also uses her bank of vote at this tribal council, which means she doesn't vote. And then something totally out of left field, Matthew also uses his shot in the dark so he can vote. So the only people that are voting in this tribal council are Brandon, Kane, and Maddie. We get the shot in the dark, Matthew's doesn't work. And the crazy thing is, Jamie's works. Jamie is the first person in Survivor history to use the shot in the dark and it works. Like, are you kidding me? Out of all the people for it to work, it works for Jamie, who wasn't even in trouble and just used it because she was like too scared to vote. I mean, I get it. Like, we have no control over, you know, who shot in the dark works, but I hate that so much. You know, the freaking plant vegetarian TikToker, she wins it. I'm not feeling it. Anyway, Brandon also uses his idol and he negates the votes that Kane and Maddie put on him, and he voted for Maddie. Maddie goes home. There you go. That's what happened in the episode. Now, for me, I liked this episode. I thought it was a pretty good episode. Tribal Council was definitely very fun. And just the problem, man, is that this cast, for the most of it, is just so bland. But here's some things I will say. They did not do sob stories. I don't know if there was a single sob story in this episode. That's great. That's awesome. Thank you for not giving us a sob story, because we only really want sob stories for people that we care about, not literally every single person on the cast. So this is a move in the right direction. I also think the episode, for what it's worth and what they were given, was edited pretty good. Like, I don't know if Matthew ever really said he was going to use a shot in the dark. Maybe he didn't, so they couldn't, you know, say he was. For what it's worth, it was edited pretty good. You know, I don't really hold premieres against a season. Like, if a premiere is bad, but a season's good, it's like whatever, you know. But for the most part, I actually think this is the best premiere in the new era out of 41, 42, 43, 44. I think 44 actually has the best premiere. So we're starting off strong. Now, always, we know things can go wrong. 43 didn't have a good premiere and ended up being the best season out of the new era. We'll see what happens, but this is a good start for the season. Now we're going to segue into something different. I kind of had this idea. I'm about to make a list, right, of the entire cast of Survivor 43 and say which players I think might end up in prison or not. I know this is completely random, but I was talking in one of my podcasts I was in with Survivor Spencer. I basically just kept saying different people that I thought were going to go to prison, so I thought I might as well make a list here of everyone I think that played in Survivor 44 that might go to prison. So here's that. All right, here we go. There's like a little thing right here. We got behind bars people that I think could probably end up in jail one day, and then they good people that I think, you know, aren't. Sarah, yeah, she's going in the no good. I mean, they good. She's, look at her, she's a square. Yamil, I think he's pretty good too. Like, maybe he does something, you know, kind of crazy, but I don't think anything jail worthy. Claire, definitely they good. I mean, come on, Claire's not doing anything. Let's see, Matthew, he's chill. He's fine. Jamie is a TikTok person, a TikTok star, or not TikTok star. I've never seen it. She does TikTok videos for a living, which I think you should go to jail if you do that, but I think she's fine. She's a square. I don't know, man. Josh is kind of weird. I think he's good, though. Heidi, yeah. She's going behind bars. I don't know what about her is. I just saw first episode, man. I don't know. I'm not getting good vibes behind bars. Helen, we didn't see much from her behind bars. Actually going to put Matthew Blankenship behind bars. I think that he could definitely do some crazy stuff. I mean, it seems like he wants to date Franny. So, yeah, that's arrestable offense. Franny's going behind bars, though. She's a square. She's not doing anything. She's, yeah. Danny, he's a firefighter. He's, yeah, I wouldn't do anything. Maddie, behind bars. I think she could definitely, like, be at a bar and then, like, just go crazy and then, like, go to jail for the night. I'm putting her behind bars. Carson's an evil mastermind. I think he tries to make an AI that kills people. He's behind bars. Carolyn, here we go. Behind bars. She already probably was behind bars once in her life. I mean, she's gonna do something crazy on the island. I think she's gonna try to murder someone on the island, actually, behind bars. Lauren, I think she's a teacher and a single mom. She's good. Bruce, he's good behind bars. My boy Brandon, here we go. Yeah, I think except Bruce behind bars. I mean, he's good. Brandon, my boy Brandon, he's good. Kane, bro. I think he could get arrested for multiple offenses. He looks like the type of guy that would do some crazy things. I'm not going to name them. If you've seen the podcast I've been on, though, you know what I'm talking about. I think there's multiple things that Kane might get arrested for. But I think Kane's destined to be behind bars at some point. And he lives in Canada, so yeah. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I got 6 people behind bars. Opposed to 12 people. Honestly though, like, I think y'all can agree with this, especially this guy right here. I'm telling you guys, you're gonna see him on the news one day if you live in Canada, because that's where he lives. Maybe it isn't national headlines. If you live in Moose Jaw, I'm pretty sure that's where he lives. Yeah, look out for this guy. Ooh, he's gonna be in the news one day. All right, peace. Anyway, guys, thank you for watching this. Survivor 44 started off good, so hopefully it can keep on rolling and keep on being a good season. Anyway, guys, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching.